So we're going to cover two topics today. We're going to cover the first topic is going to be something I call musical blueprinting. And then the second topic will be an introduction to microphones. So I typically start this discussion off by asking students, when they listen to music, what do they listen to? And the standard answer that I get is that people listen to what they do. So in other words, if you're a vocalist, you listen to the melody and the singing. If you're a guitarist, you listen to the guitar. If you're a drummer, you listen to the drums, and so on. But this practice is made up of being a producer of content, right? You are creating content from scratch, and you are trying to wear all the hats at the same time. So in other words, in the assignment you just did, you played a little bass line, you played a keyboard part maybe, you played a melody, right? Those are three different functions that are normally taken up in a performance by three different people, but you had to do it as part of the assignment. Maybe you did some drum programming, right? So music, for me, I'm going to talk about what makes a successful piece of music. And it's one word. And that word is story. Does music tell a story? When people ask me, well, what's your music like? I answer with one sentence. My music tells stories in sound. That's it. Anything else is superfluous. That's really the basic construct of everything I compose, everything I play on the piano, is telling a story. Because we're all storytellers on one way or another, and our individual existence here on this plane is a story. And music should be artful, and there are different levels of art, right? You have commercial art, you've got stuff that's pure art, and stuff that thinks it's art, but it's not. And then you have art for art carney's sake. That's a joke that only a few people will get. As some of you know, I graduated from the college in 1982, all right? And almost immediately, I worked playing through college and, you know, paid for college, and it was great. Once college ended, almost immediately afterwards, I started working in the city as a musician. And I got immediately involved in areas of the music industry that I didn't really think that I would be involved in so quickly. I always had the thought in my mind that it'd be really cool to play in a theater pit, but I didn't know that I'd make a 35-year career out of it, you know? And so I went from being someone who basically was just a keyboard player playing in a rhythm section to being part of a larger ensemble whose job it was every night to tell a story, right? And since that time, when I started playing on the off-Broadway show Little Shop of Horrors at the theater where Stomp is or was, 90% of my musical activity has been in the service of telling a story, accompanying a story. Whether it's playing in a theater pit or writing music for films and television. And that has informed and also influenced all of my creative endeavors on many levels. So there's only some of the graduate students are, you know, have music majors, and I know that some of you in this class have more musical training than some of the other recording studio fundamental classes I've taught. But when you're taught to play your instrument, right, you're taught all of the technical skills required to produce sound out of the instrument. And let's say you're studying a piece of music, you work on getting all the notes right, you practice your fingerings, your phrasing, and all this stuff, and then you play it. Having something down technically perfectly and playing it is not completely fulfilling the promise of the composition. Because most great works of music are a story. And something very simple as, you know, and typical, or I don't know what the right word is. I'm having a little half senior moment here, but, you know, Beethoven's Fifth Symphony, ba-ba-ba-bum, ba-ba-ba-bum, right? If you listen to that first movement, that's pretty much it. It just takes that those two phrases, that one rhythmic idea, and it transforms it through all of this material, and it just goes. And that's the story of the voyage of that one idea from the beginning of the piece to the end of the piece, or the movement. If you listen to a great jazz soloist, when they start playing their solo, you can see the journey and how it follows the contours of the song and creates tension during the turnarounds and develops ideas and builds on phrases and just moves you and takes you through an event. It's not just a bunch of notes. It's not playing scales and Charlie Parker licks and all this stuff. Great music is storytelling, irrespective of being attached to a visual. Right? So, what we're going to do, though, today is we're going to think about this a little bit differently. We'll come at music a little bit differently than you might have been exposed to it in the past. A play, let's think in terms of a musical or a play, right? A musical or a play is 2 to 3 hours long, typically, like a Broadway show. And a great show, the character at the end of the show is changed from the character at the beginning of the show. They've gone through a journey. And that journey is unfolding on multiple levels simultaneously. Just like great music unfolds on multiple levels simultaneously over time. Now, what do I mean by that? Well, in a play, sometimes you have, let's say it's a musical. You have book scenes. You have scenes where people are singing. You have scenes where it's one or two people singing the whole song. You have scenes where it's a small ensemble of people singing a whole song. You have scenes where the entire cast is on stage singing a whole song. You have scenes where there's one or two people on stage. You have scenes where there's many people on stage, right? So you think about all this is happening at the same time. Those are different levels. And where they're placed on the timeline from the beginning of the piece to the end of the piece, right? And I'm not talking about the songs. I'm talking about the background concept of the beginning of the show to the end of the show, right? where they're placed is very important, because you want to take somebody along on a journey over a long arc of 3 hours, right? So you want to have, you want things where they have to really pay attention because it's quiet, and you want to have things where it's really loud and it's in their face, and maybe there's times where they're looking over at stage right and times they're looking over at stage left, and sometimes stuff's happening right in the middle, sometimes people are really close to the audience, sometimes that people are way in the back, sometimes stages have a big rake, which is an angle, and that gives you a greater sense of depth and makes things seem further away than if it was flat. And so there's lighting that's involved, there's sound effects that's involved, there's orchestration of the songs that's involved. So there's so many things involved, and where they're all placed in the timeline, how dense things are contrasts with how sparse things are. All this stuff adds up to a compelling narrative that will drag the listener or the viewer along. And it's the same in a song. That's successful to me, right? Now, not every song has to be big. There are songs that it just, you know, somebody singing and somebody playing guitar, acoustic guitar, that are like unbelievable. But they all have that element of drama unfolding or story unfolding that takes you along for the ride. So I've named a few things here that are specific to theater pieces. So can anybody think of aspects of what I just said about how a play develops and how that might fit into a piece of music that you listen to? Okay, let's talk about this, right? Does everything happen in the center stage? No. Right? So you've got one side of the stage, and then you've got the other side of the stage, and things happen sometimes left, sometimes right, sometimes center, sometimes a little left, sometimes a little right. Sometimes things happen right in front of your face. Whoops, excuse me. And sometimes things happen further away from you, and that's being blocked by the microphone. Right. Sometimes things happen further away, and sometimes things happen closer to you. And all of those things affect how you pay attention to the performance. So how does this relate to listening to a piece of music?
Perhaps you can start off soft and then gradually develop it. Or maybe you can present one instrument as more dominant like than the other or something like that. Some sort of like variation throughout the song. So it can definitely start with like simple notes, maybe like you can even start off the song in a 4/4 time signature, and then gradually you'll emphasize some syncopations.
All this stuff is good. Yep. All that stuff is good. True. Yes. So, and everything you said there is accurate, but as far as it relating to theater, well, most of us are listening to music with two speakers, whether it's, you know, in your stereo system at your home or earbuds or headphones. You've got a left and a right. So that's two dimensions, just left and right. And we want to create a multidimensional space inside of those two dimensions. So like on the stage, sometimes things are coming out of the left ear. Sometimes you sense that things are coming out of the middle and maybe a little bit to the left, and same thing on the right. Sometimes things sound like they're right in your face, and sometimes things sound like they're further away. And so that's like, I've got this thing, and I might have mentioned this to you last week, or was it to the Audio MIDI too? I forget. But there are four dimensions. This is what I like to talk about, is that there are four dimensions to mixing a piece of music. There's volume, how soft something is to how loud something is. There's pitch. Is it a low pitch, a medium pitch, or a high pitch? or somewhere in between. The panning, or on a stage. So if you look at a band on a stage, some people are on the left and some people are on the right. The drums are usually in the middle, unless it's a jazz trio, in which case the drums might be on the right, and the piano's on the left, and the bass is in the middle, right? So you've got left, center, and right. And then is something front or back, further away, right? So that's front to back. So that's four dimensions, soft to loud, low pitch to high pitch, left to right panning, and front to back, how close something is to you, depth. And a good mix will have all of those dimensions, no matter how simple the song is or how complex the song is, working in concert or in together to help tell the story. Now, what we're going to do today is going to be, some of it's going to be a little bit difficult because Zoom is mono and I'm going to be talking about stuff left and right. But if you go and watch the review video, you'll be able to hear it in stereo because it'll be in stereo. And I'll timestamp where this stuff is so that you can get right to it. So let's do this. Just give me 1 second. For some reason, things changed from the last time this was open. Okay. Great. So I like to talk about the band Steely Dan, not because I think they're great, although I do, but because that's no good. But because they do things on a technical level that's incredible. Give me 1 second here. Great. Okay, so we're going to listen to this song from the Asia album, and Alan, you've heard this before. It's called Black Cow, and it's a good song. Is it a great song? No, but what is great about it is the way that it unfolds, the way that everything is panned, and the way that you can hear every instrument. So what I did here was I made a little chart. And this has two of our four dimensions in it. So low pitch is over in this area here, and high pitch, and this chart is in our Dropbox in class 7, I believe. This is high pitched right here, and then this is left, and this is right. Okay? So if we look at this and we go from the low pitch to the high pitch, we've got the kick drum, the bass guitar, then the tom-toms on the drum kit, the snare drum, and then the electric piano. And then right here, we've got brass. Now you notice that I've got these all color coordinated. So our brass are all this flesh color or whatever that is, because the brass is in the center one time, and then they overdub it. They do two tracks of it. One is on the left and one is on the right another time. And then they do the same thing with the green are the background vocals. They're all in different places. And it's really interesting how they do that as the song unfolds, and then the pink is the lead vocal. Now, you'll notice over here, there's another pink, right? You won't be able to tell this on the mono Zoom feed, but again, if you listen to this in stereo, the lead vocal is in the center, and the reverb for the lead vocal is over on the right. And then the same thing with the clavinet is here, which is a keyboard instrument, and the reverb for that is over here. And one of the guitars is here, and the reverb is over here in the pan. And then we, on the higher instruments, we've got our cymbals. So I made this panning map. And why did I do this? Partially to use it to teach the class. But I do stuff like this, not as detailed as this. I'll use just a regular piece of paper, and I'll listen, and I'll take notes as to where everything is. And this will be important for your next assignment that'll be due next week as we get into this. All right, so any questions on this?
Why would they move the reverb to the other side of the different
instruments? Yeah, so to give space and to give a sense of width to the mix. Yes, Matthew.
Sorry, this is not really a question about this, but just a question pertaining to some of the Pro Tools plugins that we were supposed to use for our song assignment. Can I ask the question?
Yes.
Okay, cool. So just because I have experience like writing and scoring music on a computer, I've noticed that expand instruments, like their velocities tend to not really, they tend to correspond more to the actual volume rather than the like nuance or the attack.
Correct.
Is that?
Correct. That's because
Right.
So they, I think the most number of dynamics that I've seen is two levels on any of the samples in expand. It when it came out 10 or 15 years ago, it was really good. And it's still a useful teaching tool.
Yeah.
But it needs to be updated greatly.
Okay. All right. Thank you.
Yep. That's exactly right. That's a very good observation.
Okay. Thank you.
Sure. Okay. Let me now. All right, so let's take a listen to the song, and I'm going to mute these two. Now, I'm going to pop this up on YouTube, and they'll let this play. They won't block it, so it'll be fine. So the purple one here, that's the left and right. Oops, give me 1 second.
You should know how all the pros play the game.
Okay, so that's the first almost three minutes. Now, notice that I've changed the counter in Pro Tools. If you click here, you can change it from what we've been using, which is bars and beats, to minutes and seconds. And you'll do that for the upcoming assignment because you'll import your track into Pro Tools. I have a whole folder's worth of songs that you're going to work with. Now, I'm going to make these, tracks inactive right now because I don't want a chance that they'll come on. So I'm just going to make them inactive. Yes.
So these are the stems?
No, this is just a stereo mix that I imported into Pro Tools. And then I did some work with them using some trickery to separate out the center from the sides, which will help us.
Okay.
That's the pink and the blue. So the pink are the sides and this blue here are the center. And this is the original left and right. All right, so let me just hide that actually so that it's not confusing us. So if we listen now, this should be the same exact mix. Oh, I don't really want the click track. Great. All right, so musical blueprinting. What I want you to do, and I'll show you I have a folder filled with songs. You pick a song. And what I want you to do is to type out a timeline and tell me what's happening at certain points in the song. So I'm going to show you what I'm doing here. You don't have to be as detailed as we're going to get into here, right? But what this does is it gets you to listen to the mix and how the mix and the song unfolds the story as opposed to just listening to the melody and the lyrics or just the drum beat. You're starting to listen to the entire package. And that's very helpful with learning how to mix music together. It's training your ears. So if you're a music major, you take ear training, which is sight singing and dictation. And that's a great skill. And this is a great skill also, learning how to listen into big conglomerate sound and pick out the individual elements and figure out what they're doing. You know, this tangential story, which some of you have also heard, is, and that I like to tell because it's so telling. So John Coltrane, one of the great musicians of all time. And I read an interview with him and he was talking about how he studies music, right? So he could read music and when he would look at classical music, he would get a score and he would study the score. But when he'd study a jazz piece, he'd get the recording and he'd play the recording a few times and just take the whole thing in. And then what he would do would be start from the bottom up and focus in on the individual instruments and play it over and over again and just listen to each instrument until he could sing its part. So he would listen to the drums. Maybe he'd have to listen to it 5 or 10 or 15 times over and over again until he could sing the drum fills, the kind of beat, bucket-a-boom, bucket-a-boom. Then he'd do the same thing with the bass and sing every note the bass player was playing. Then he'd listen to how the drums and the bass played together and how they communicated with each other to create the groove and the swing. Then he'd see how the piano played and how the piano played chords and how that fit in with the, then he'd listen to how it fit in with the bass and the drums. Then he'd listen to whoever was playing the melody and the solos and see how all that fit into what the foundation was creating. So he's doing sort of what we're doing here. And if, you know, it's really a good practice. It's something to really learn how to know what's going on inside of a piece of music. All right. So we're starting off here very simply, right? The song is starting off simply. So there's that bree, the high note on the guitar, but then there's just how many other instruments are there besides that playing? So let's see if any of you can venture a guess. So can anybody name one of the instruments that's playing? Okay. Bass and drums. Yes, that's good. Great. I'm seeing bass, drums, and then one guitar. There's one other instrument. So you're missing one instrument.
Keyboard?
Yeah, a keyboard. Bam. wow, 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 right? And it's playing the same thing the bass is playing, but it's got almost like a wah-ish kind of a sound. That's called a clavinet. A clavinet is a keyboard instrument, and it creates sound by plucking the string with a little hook, almost like a harpsichord. And you all know what the sound of a clavinet is if you've heard Superstition by Stevie Wonder. It's all over that song and many songs he's played. Yeah. So we're starting off with just that. Now let's listen to just the center. You can hear a little bit of the bass and guitar, but it's mostly just the drum. Right? Playing a very simple beat. Now let's listen to the left. You guys can hear that, right? Okay, so right there, let's do it reversed. Let's listen to the right side first. So that's that keyboard, and you can hear the bass, and you can hear a little bit of the drums. Right? So now we're listening to the left, which you're going to hear in the center because you're in mono, but in the left you have... That's a reverb from that keyboard part, panned all the way to the other side. Right? So that's interesting, right? Instead of it being... It sort of gives you a fake stereo field, and it widens it up a little bit, and it also keeps the sound of the clavinet very clean, because that's only coming out of one speaker. But that's just an interesting way to spread the content out. Right, so then right over here, the guitar jumps down and plays a chord. Bring. So the first time through, the guitar is playing that high pitch. And then the second time through, it jumps down an octave and plays that chord strummed just once. So it's doing the same, it's filling the same amount of rhythm. It's changing the pitch down an octave. And that is part of telling the story. As things are unfolding over time, they're transforming. And then now, one, two, three, four. And notice the guitarist, he's not going, he's going, bring, because it's still the beginning of the song, just the introduction. So if I was going to write my assignment here, you know, song starts off simply with just keyboard, bass, and drums. And if you can hear that the keyboard is panned to the right and the reverb is panned to the left, you'd put that in there. And that would be at the beginning of the song. Let's say right now I've got it at 3 seconds, but let's say that this was all right at the beginning. It would be at the beginning of the song, and then the guitar jumps down an octave at 13 seconds into the song, or, you know, in the second eight or second four. So you would just write that out in your notes. In the corner of my eye. Now, the verse starts. I'm going to mute the vocals, all right? You'll hear a little bit of the vocals because you'll hear the reverb. Listen to how the music changes here. Let's listen to that one more time. So here's with the introduction. So we've got the bass and that keyboard playing in unison, and we've got the guitar just playing chords, simple chords that are like what we'd call footballs or whole notes. Two. And now the verse starts. One, two, three, boom. In the corner So how does the guitar change? Yes, Al, good. Clav drops. The clavinet does not drop out. It changes the pattern. Listen. It sounds like it drops out because it blends in with the guitar. That might even be a Rhodes. I can't hear it, but there's definitely a keyboard there. Right? So we're going through the song and we're hearing how it's arranged and how it's put together. We are boob. And then on You Were High, repeated, you got that offbeat accent and then harmony vocals. And you can see here that the harmony vocals are panned very far left and right. And it's over here. Now, if we listen to the center, right, you can't hear the background vocals when we're hearing just the center. All right, so let's take it here. Let's listen to it with just the vocal. Yeah. Actually, Al, the clavinet drops out and it's electric piano there. It's just very quiet. So here. Right there, it's louder. And the clavinet comes back in. So you could just hear how all it just every couple of bars, the texture and the combination shift, and all this stuff keeps your interest. And this is a part of making a great arrangement, and part of making a good mix is getting all these things to fit in together so that you can hear everything. You were high. It was a crying disgrace. They saw your face on the counter by your keys. So the second time through, there's a little bit more activity in the clavinet. It's very soft, but it fits in with the guitar. Bip, bip, ba. It's doing the bip, ba. When he's playing that figure, boo da be ya, and the clavinet's going, doo da be ya. Right there. Be ya. Okay, so if I was going to blueprint this, what I would do would be, I would note the time. So at the beginning or the first verse, the intro starts off simply, bass, drums, and keyboard and guitar. Second time through the intro, the guitar figure changes. When the verse starts, it's solo voice, and you know, at the verse starts at whatever it is, 20 seconds. Solo voice, guitar pattern changes, keyboard gets softer. Then at whatever it is, 22 seconds, the harmonies come in, and they're just emphasizing a couple, and whatever the words were, you were high, right? So you're creating a timeline, and you're seeing where things come in that timeline, and you're just sort of creating a structure and an outline where you can just go through the song and be able to pick out all the instruments when you're listening, right? But then how that happens as the song builds. So let's just continue on with this. All right, so there's this little, this part that goes, I can't cry anymore. That might be considered the chorus, but listen to how the drum pattern changes leading into that.
But where are you tomorrow?
Starting here.
I can't cry.
So does anybody, I'll listen to that again and I'll turn off the voices. Yeah, it's that's not a good idea because a lot of the drums are in the center. So listen to, everybody knows what the hi-hat is. The hi-hat is the part that goes t-t-t-t-t-t-t. And it's usually, if it's a right-handed drummer, it's on their left, by their left hand arm. So listen to how that pattern changes as you're getting to the chorus. It's leading you to the chorus. Very tight. Now starting here, it gets looser. Right, it's, instead of it being, it's going. The drummer is just opening the drums, the hi-hat, just a little bit. Right, it's two cymbals, one on top of each other. He's just reducing the pressure on the foot pedal, and they're opening just a little bit, and when he's hitting them, it gets that swishier kind of a sound, right? And that's paying attention to what's going on. That's important to lead you. It's helping to lead you and let you know that something is coming.
Surely we'll screen out the sorrow, but where are you tomorrow? I can't cry anymore.
So you hear the chorus. Let's bring the original tracks back. Oh, actually, let's do this. No, I don't have that. Let's do this. You can look at the waveform, right? And you can see how in this area here, see what that shape looks like? And then when you get, this is the chorus over here. You see how that's much more busy and complex? You can see it in the waveform that there's more stuff going on in this area here. This looks sparser. It's complex, but you could see that there's little space. There's space here. There's space here. In this area here, there's spaces, but the volume is louder. It's really, you could just look at the waveform and see how the arrangement has dynamics.
Daylight.
So you would say right before the first chorus. Also, brass comes in, which helps. And I'm listening to the choir, the female singers now, and they're coming out. You can hear that they were recorded twice, and they've panned one all the way to the left and the other all the way to the right. So let's close the center and let's listen to the left. On the right. And now let's just listen to the center. So they're there as well.
Break away. Just when it seems so clear that it's over now. Drink your big black count and get out of here.
So notice that the chorus tends to be dynamically what compared to a verse, just in general. Yep, got that out, good. Right, dynamically, right? Is it louder? Is it softer? Is it busier? Is it bigger? Is it smaller? It's bigger. It's the part that you want people to remember. Usually in the chorus, there's harmony vocals. You know, you have, in this case, in here, you've got brass supporting it. So it's bigger. And that's, think about at the beginning, let's do this. You see how that sounds compared to? So you can hear how sparse that is. So you'd have, maybe you'd write after the first chorus, there's a brass interlude, and then a keyboard solo at 252. And then how do the drums change at during the keyboard solo? Listen. Yes, Matthew.
Sounded like he switched to the ride symbol.
Exactly.
It was playing like a, instead of halftime, like instead of on every three, it was like the snare was hitting on two and four. I don't know. I couldn't.
Yeah. It's busier, but the main thing is it switches to the ride symbol and that changes the texture. So the ride symbol is, for those of you that don't know, it's typically the symbol that they play with their right hand. It's on a stand and it's used for keeping time as opposed to a crash symbol, which a ride cymbal can also serve the function of a crash, which is used for accents, the crash cymbal. So listen to how it changes the texture in the drums. It's really tight, the drums, right? And now it adds a sheen and opens up the sound. And it's kind of cool because it leaves space for the keyboard to play in the same pitch register that the hi-hat was in. So when he opens up to the ride cymbal like that, right, he's leaving that hole there that the keyboard player is now stepping out and taking center stage. That's part of the story. So you see how, as this song is unfolding, there's so many different dynamic levels going on. And the other thing too is it sounds great. This album is considered by many people, myself included, to be one of the greatest engineered and mixed albums ever. And it's considered to be like the prime example of the ultimate of analog recording onto a reel-to-reel recorder, not digital. And because they had an amazing combination of a great engineer, good songwriting, and the best studio musicians that money could buy. Seriously. I wrote down who was playing on this. So Larry Carlton on guitar, one of the great studio guitarists. Victor Feldman, great keyboard player and vibe player. He played with Miles Davis. Joe Sample, one of the great jazz keyboard players. He's playing the clavinet. Paul Humphrey, great drums. Chuck Rainey, one of the great bass players. And Tom Scott, amazing saxophone player, and he wrote out a brass section. I don't know who that was, and I couldn't find out who the females that were singing were. But, you know, the list of players here, these are like legendary studio musicians, and they're playing on this track. So you add like a great studio with great equipment, a great engineer, song, and great players, and it's hard to miss having something sound great. It was sort of like a confluence of everything, the best of everything. And sometimes the best of everything doesn't add up to being greater than the sum of its parts, but this time it did. Because everybody, the great thing about those guys is that they all knew that they were there to service the song and not their own egos. So that's really great. All right, so any questions on this? All right, so in our Dropbox folder, there is a folder called Music for Blueprinting. And there is a wide variety of music here. Radiohead. There's a band called Love from the 1960s. Well, that doesn't sound good. Hold on. Sarah McLachlan. There's Austin Powers. There's Queen. Earth, Wind, and Fire. Some of this stuff is older music. This is kind of new. This says 1995, but this is new. This is Ólafur Arnalds. He's an Icelandic film and television composer and recording artist. He's very interesting. You've got Stevie Wonder. Taylor Swift. You've got Daft Punk. So I've got a bunch of stuff. I've got a few things of mine. If you want to look at it, you got Paul Simon. Got The Boss. Just a little side note. So Bruce Springsteen has an album coming out soon. And yesterday, Twitter made a little emoji that was Bruce Springsteen in one of his iconic positions. It's really fun. I found it very humorous. Anyway, that's a little side note. So what you'll do is you'll pick one of those songs, and I'm going to write this out tomorrow morning and post it up on Google Classroom. And you're going to make an outline of this, and you're going to just do what we just did here. You know, you're just going to figure out what's happening when, and you're just going to say, this is happening at one at you know, right at the beginning, at 20 seconds in, this is happening. The second verse, which is at 30 seconds in, this is happening. And, you know, you just write out what's going on musically and how it, and if you can add in how it supports unfolding the story of the song, that would be great too. So like I said, I'll write out something a little bit more specific and I'll post it up. And then, you know, it's a short turnaround for our next class. And I know that some of you are a little behind possibly. So I'm going to make this due on the 26th of October. So you'll have, you know, a bit of time to get to this.